Hello. I thought you'd want to come back. Do you remember last time we spoke about Lady Blossomberry and how she was banished? Yes, I know. Banished. It's rather sad. And now we're going to go back to Thimble and find out how she's getting on with that cake. I do hope she knows what she's doing. Queen Lilibell was in a jovial mood, having just eaten three cakes, two apple-filled pastries, and was halfway through a plate of cream scones when Lord Flute arrived, goodness, with his delivery.
Your Majesty, I have a rather important note for your attention, said Lord Flute, bowing as he entered her chambers.
Lilibell looked up with some excitement.
Ooh, good. Sounds serious, Flutey. Will it give me an opportunity to show off my new clothes?
She exclaimed, swishing the fabric of another new red gown around the floor. The royal tailors had been rather hard at work recently, making new clothes for the Queen's ever-growing waistline. Don't be rude. Lord Flute pulled the manuscript out from his coat and handed it to the Queen, who opened it hurriedly. But her excitement was soon replaced with a little disappointment when she saw it was just another call for council.
Oh, another boring council meeting. Oh, but I see it will be with Thimble. I suppose that makes it a little bit more interesting,
said the Queen before leaving the room with two knaves following closely behind her. Lord Flute bowed again and she was gone.
Oh dear,
said Lord Flute and hurriedly set about preparation for the council meeting. Queen Lilibell had been ruler for 205 full moons and one astral comet. During her reign, little had changed in the valley, and it remained a peaceful haven for all its occupants. But as it was now coming up to another full moon in Aries, and with no children to succeed her, Lilibell knew she would have to appoint another royal as her successor. And soon, and as Till was her closest relative, she had reluctantly decided to make him the crown sovereign. By arranging his marriage to the talented Thimble, the Queen had hoped that the little fairy's bright and brilliant mind would guide Till when one day he became king. The truth was, of course, Lady Blossomberry was her true successor. And the Queen deeply wished that she could offer her throne, as she would have made such a wonderful queen. Lilibell sighed her deepest sigh and sipped her hot chocolate as she stared out of the window of the palace library, a place where she knew Blossom loved to spend her time. A promise is a promise, she whispered to herself, before making her way back to her chamber for her mid-morning nap. Oh dear, rather sad.
Your Majesty,
said Thimble loudly as she addressed the pink swamp in preparation of her impending meeting. Clearing her throat, she stood up as straight and tall as she could and addressed the swamp.
Your Majesty, I come with a warrior's heart and a scholar's mind to ask you to reconsider...
Oh, said Thimble. She paused, composed herself, and then stamped on the floor, turning an unsuspecting patch of daisies black. This often happened when Thimble got cross with things, and she would have to compose herself, as turning the Queen's flowers any other shade than they should be could be disastrous.
I know. Why can I not remember what to say when what I want to say is so simple? Said Thimble, pulling out twig and turning the daisies back to the colour they should have been.
It was fast approaching noontime and Thimble would have to hurry. But she felt a million miles away from prepared.
Right, Twig, do your very best.
And Thimble blasted herself with sparkles and stars to reveal perfectly glowing face and ringlets so perfectly spun that even Thimble approved.
Perfect,
she exclaimed, admiring her reflection in the pink swamp, before putting Twig back in her bag. I feel better already. And she hovered off to find Prunus and Myrtle for some last-minute words of wisdom. The great hall had been prepared for council. All the candles were lit in their majestic three-tiered stands. The huge table was so polished that you could see the reflection of the flames dance across it like, well, fairy lights. And the knaves were in two long rows either side of the huge hall's marble floor, twitching and shuffling impatiently for council to begin. Lord Flute sat at the head of the table, near the Queen's throne, which sat at the top of three low steps and was busy writing things on his scroll, trying to calm his nerves. He knew only too well how temperamental the Queen could become if things did not go the way she had planned. The giant troll clock, with its five hands, a gift of prolonged peace from the Troll King, Doran, four Aquarian moons ago, sat above the bookcase and boomed loudly for the first chime of noon. The door swung open and in came Lilibell herself, majestic and magnificent, in a red velvet gown with trimmings of lace and embroidery, two knaves always following closely behind her.
All rise,
commanded Lord Flute to all the senior courtiers and the other royals, including Till, rose as the Queen made her way to her throne.
Yes, do sit, I'm bored already.
Oh, so Flutie, today's council is for what exactly?
Said Lilibell as she seated herself while producing a red feather fan from her pocket to point with. Lord Flute shuffled his paper scrolls nervously and was just about to address the great hall when the trumpeters played a fanfare and in walked Thimble wearing her smartest red and green kilt, closely followed by Myrtle pushing a huge trolley, displaying the most magnificent cake anyone in the room had ever seen. There were loud gasps as it was wheeled in front of council, its bright pink icing glistening in the candle's flames, and the intricate red and purple flowers that it adorned looked so real, you would have thought that Prunus had grown them in the royal gardens. Myrtle curtsied, gave a tiny wink to Thimble, and gracefully bowed out through the open doors, shutting them behind her. The Queen clapped with excitement.
How absolutely, wonderfully unexpected, Thimble! You have brought us all cake!
Thimble was relieved that the Queen seemed delighted. Your Majesty, said Thimble as she bowed her head to the floor in front of the Queen's throne.
This cake is a gift from me to you.
And she looked up to see if her father was looking as impressed as Lilibell, but he was still scroll shuffling nervously.
A gift! How kind and thoughtful of you, little fairy, but I imagine that council was not called to present cakes, but to discuss your forthcoming wedding to my dear nephew, Tilano Toil.
Till bowed to the council as if he had just won a raffle of some great order, which of course he had. Thimble cleared her throat.
Your Majesty, indeed I have come to discuss the wedding plans, but I fear not how you would have imagined them, she said bravely.
The room fell silent as everybody listened intently to what Thimble was saying. The Queen laughed.
No, of course not. I'm sure you have many ideas of your own on how you want the day to unfold, and I'm so pleased, Thimble, that you are such a creative fairy. I'm sure that you will have wonderful things in store, said Lilibell, clapping her hands as she walked around the cake. If this wonderful creation is anything to go by, we shall all be in for a real treat.
And the whole room applauded with excitement. Thimble knew that she had to speak and fast, or the whole calling of council would have been a complete and utter waste of time.
Your Majesty, I am so humbly grateful that you think so highly of my abilities to offer me the hand of your only nephew. And I'm honoured beyond all the stars in the skies that you assume so much of my talents. But, Your Majesty, I'm here to appeal to you to put a stop to this ridiculous marriage and end the total utter misery I find myself in. And with that, the room stood still. And for what seemed like a very long time, no one even breathed. Lord Flute stopped paper shuffling and was now chewing his feather quill. The knaves were no longer twitching, but had their mouths so wide open it looked like they were about to burst into song. And Till stood with a bit of dribble rolling down his side of his mouth and looked white as a sheet.
"I'm sorry, what did you say?"
exclaimed Lilybell.
"You do not want what, Fairy Child?"
bellowed Lilybell.
"You say you do not want this marriage to Till?"
she inquired further. Thimble cleared her throat. "No, Your Majesty, I most certainly do not." There was total pin-dropping silence.
"I know."
Not a breath was taken or a word spoken, and to Thimble it seemed as though it was time standing still. Then very slowly the room began to whisper and shuffle. Fairy elbows nudged the one sat next to them. And before you could blink, the room was alive with the sound of discussion and gossip and sniggering until...
"Silence!"
commanded Lilybell. And the room fell silent again as order was resumed.
"Oh! Those are the calling birds! That's a very awkward place to leave it. Oh dear! I'm going to have to go. I know you shall want to come back next time and find out what on earth is going to happen next." Thimble's left herself in quite a predicament. Anyway, until next time, take care. And remember, don't stop believing, especially in you.